So the topic today which I am going to cover, technology development towards fast breeder reactors. Technology development of fast breeder reactors the technology development towards fast breeder reactor started as early as 1965 and continued till today. So it is very difficult what I want to tell this. I will be covering only a small fraction of the technology development were carried out in IGCAR, BRC, and other constituent units of Department of Atomic Energy. And the small fraction of work which I am going to cover today is also not the work done by me. I have made a supervisory role in these activities, so it is not my own work. Another point is there is nothing new. All the activities which were carried out in IGCAR over years until till my retirement in 2016, I am planning to give a brief summary of some of the activities which I was involved. And there is nothing to. Then some of you may ask a question, then what is the relevance of this talk? I also have a doubt. I hope end of my talk, the audience, around 30-40 police, my friends are attending this meeting, they will be able to answer me about the relevance. Right. Coming to the organization of the talk, I will give a brief introduction, history about the program, development towards FBTR and then PFBR. PFBR technology development, I will give slightly more in detail, and then about the technology of future FBRs, and I will conclude. Coming to, as Mr. Govindan Kutty was telling, three-stage nuclear power program of our country. The second stage, fast breeder reactors. According to Dr. Raja Ramanna, once he told, fast breeder reactors are the eighth wonders of the world. Why? Because fast breeder reactors produce power, energy. In addition to that, it produces fuel. And the fuel production or the fuel production is more than the consumption rate. It's really a wonder. So that is the relevance or significance of fast breeder reactors. In other words, I will say the natural uranium available in our country by using the thermal reactors or the mastered PHWR technology, we will be able to use 0.7% of the natural uranium available in our country. 99.3% can only be used by effectively used by fast breeder reactor technology. And the potential is 5,30,000 megawatt electricity can be produced by fast breeder reactor technology by using it, by using the natural uranium or converting the fertile isotope into fissile isotope. Not only that, the large resources of thorium available in our country can be converted into fissile material and can be used for energy, for solving the energy situation or solving the energy scenario of our country. Fast breeder reactors are required. So this technology is very, very relevant because of these two reasons. And now I will go to the history. Because of these two reasons, Homi Baba Jahangir Baba has initiated the fast reactor program. In 1965, a fast reactor section was formed in BRC under late Sri S.R. Paranjpai. S.R. Paranjpai is among his friend circle, he is known as Mr. Fast Reactor. Mr. Paranjpai photograph we can see. He is the pioneer in fast reactor technology, and 1965 started the program. He took up the design of a 10 megawatt experimental fast reactor in RED in BRC in 1965. Later on, after the sudden demise of Swami Baba, as all of you know, our Vikram Sarabhai took over as chairman. And 1966, he took a bold step to speed up the introduction of fast reactor program in our country. So Sarabhai was the man who took a bold step to speed up the program. And at that time, France was the pioneer of nuclear energy, and 75% of the power in France was by nuclear or the atomic energy. And not only that, they were the leaders of fast breeder reactor technology, and having a test reactor by name Rapsodi Fortissimo, and then the Finnish reactor was under construction at that time. So we have they offered a collaboration with India, and a bilateral agreement was signed in 1969. And IGCAR, or the RRC at that time, Reactor Research Center, currently the Indira Gandhi Center for Atomic Research, was established in 1971 for exclusively for the development of fast breeder reactor technology. Around 50 engineers led by Mr. Fast Reactor S.R. Paranjapai was moved to IGCAR or the RRC at that time in June 1971. So the design of ABTR, our ABTR was almost similar to Rapsodi in the primary circuit, but in the Rapsodi we have only the primary circuit, and the secondary circuit we have the sodium to air heat exchanges. But in ABTR, in order to demonstrate the electrical electricity generation, we have added steam generators, 4 modules, and the steam water system, and then the turbine generator, etc. So that the complete demonstration of electricity generation through fast breeder reactors was possible in ABTR, and that was a major change in ABTR compared to Rapsodi. The construction of the reactor started in 1972, and the first criticality after was a long time, after 13 years, because of many reasons. Because of the nuclear explosion at Pokhran, France withdrawn the support, and most of the thing we have to do on our own. But after 13 years in 1985, without the support of France, we could make the reactor critical in 1985. Until today, the ABTR was in operation, and I think the last campaign, we have gone up to a power of 32 megawatt thermal and 8 megawatt electrical, and almost all the design parameters we have achieved, and the experience was excellent. Based on the experience in the design and construction of ABTR, DAE decided to launch the design of 500 megawatt prototype fast breeder reactor PFBR, which is also in the commissioning stage at Kalpakkam today. And now the RRC 1971, we have RRC activities were initiated, and I told you a 50 member team has shifted to this IG Kalpakkam for the present IGCAR. And there the main design and development, manufacturing of the components, etc., were done in industry. But the testing of reactor components or testing of fast reactor components, sodium facilities was required. So sodium facilities have been designed, constructed, and operated in IGCAR from 1971. The first sodium system which was commissioned in IGCAR or RRC at that time was 500 kilowatt loop. 500 kilowatt loop is very similar to a 500 kilowatt capacity nuclear reactor. Instead of nuclear power, by means of electrical heaters, the power of 500 kilowatt was generated or given to the system. And all other things, that is, we have the heat exchanges, we have the sodium purification, sodium pumping, all other sodium systems, very similar to a reactor, was there in the 500 kilowatt loop. And that loop was commissioned in the year 1972 or 73. And the sodium technology experiments were commenced as early as 1973 in IGCAR. You can see a view of 500 kilowatt loop and the sodium pump used in centrifugal sodium pump used in IG in the 500 kilowatt loop, and the sodium purification facility, and some of the technology development experiments towards ABTR, which was carried out in IGCAR in the 70s in Reactor Engineering Laboratory, the present Fast Reactor Technology Group. And Mr. C.V. Sundaram was the director or second director of IGCL. I could not get a photograph, sorry, of Srinivasan, the first director, and Plastic Rotaries and S.B. Bhoje. These are the people who are involved in the activities of first theatre program or technology development those days. And about FBTR, I have already told, this is a 40 megawatt thermal reactor vessel. We have the radioactive primary circuit, and then it's a loop type of reactor, radioactive primary circuit, and the secondary circuit is non-radioactive sodium. So the Rhapsody, they were not having the steam generator. So from this line onwards, from this section onwards, everything was new compared to Rhapsody. These were all Indian addition. So we have added steam generator, we have added the steam turbine generator and the conventional steam water system. And that was the major change with respect to Rhapsody, and FBTR was able to produce electricity and demonstrate the power generation in all respect compared to our Rhapsody reactor in France. And now the first, our target, I mean, the FBTR was, construction was started in the year 1972, I have already mentioned. And the in support of FBTR, many experiments were carried out. I will say the major experiment or the major task was the purification of around 150 tons of commercial grade sodium. The reactor needs sodium 150 tons in quantity. Not only that, the purity requirement was 99.95%, or the ppm level of impurity was only 500 ppm, and oxygen and hydrogen should be less than 10 ppm, and hydrogen level was 2 ppm. That was the specification. This purification, so manufacturing of sodium, transportation to Kalpakkam, purification, and then charging into reactor was a technology development activity, because we were not sure about the, we are new to sodium, and the entire technology was developed and successfully carried out the sodium purification and charging of sodium into FBTR in the year 1983-84. Then the shutdown mechanisms were tested, qualified, and delivered to reactor, inside the reactor, and calibration of sodium flow meters and calibration of in-sodium hydrogen detectors, vapor deposition experiments, because sodium vapor will go and deposit in annular regions, and it can give problems of solidification. The movement of the components like shutdown mechanisms, once it is dropped, it may not get dropped. Such problems can happen. So such studies were carried out in the initial phase in reactor engineering laboratory. And development of safety devices like rupture disc for sodium water reaction detection, and sodium water reaction, if it is happening, safety has to be ensured. So the sodium water reaction has to be isolated, and the sodium pressure has to be released. For that, we are using the rupture disc that has been developed in IGCAR and tested. So photograph for sodium bix charging into the sodium melter tanks, melting, filtering, cold dropping, and bringing to the purity, required purity level by different stages of purification, I can say. Later, the liquid sodium, which was purified in REL, was transported to reactor building, which is FBTR secondary sodium system, where the sodium was charged initially, flow meter calibration system, and the secondary sodium, the building, reactor building, where the sodium storage tank was located, where the liquid sodium was transported. Coming to IGCAR and the major thrust areas of IGCAR. See, IGCAR, the present strength is around 2,300 or so, in which 600 to 700 offices with multidisciplinary qualifications and multidisciplinary expertise. So from reactor design, reactor physics, reactor engineering, sodium technology, reactor safety and sodium safety, infrastructure support like engineering services group, electronics and instrumentation, materials development, because ODM systems need a better material and material development and testing, and basic sciences, fundamental research, all areas of fast reactor engineering and technology, or fast reactor, FBR, fast beta reactor, closed fuel cycle technologies, reprocessing also is being carried out in IGCAR. So it's a multidisciplinary center with all aspects of reactor technology is covered. And what I am going to cover is only a small fraction of the thing, which I have already mentioned to you, and I will come to that in the coming slides. Coming to the fast breeder, 500 megawatt prototype fast breeder reactor, it's a pool type of reactor. It is different from the loop type FBTR. Pool type of reactor, we have a large vessel of around 13 meter in diameter and 13 meter in height, 1.3 meter in diameter and 1.3 meter in height, and around 1,100 tons of sodium it can hold. You can imagine the size of the vessel. All the primary radioactive sodium is contained inside the reactor vessel, where we have the core support structure, and the core is located, and the vessel is covered with the roof slab, and where all the reactor components are inserted through the rotating plugs are there, control plug is there, and the small rotating plug, large rotating plug, and the roof slab through which the pumps, heat exchanges, and all the main reactor components are inserted to the reactor vessel. And the secondary sodium, which is coming out of the reactor, will be hot secondary sodium, and is going to a surge tank and to the steam generator. So this hot sodium transfers the heat to the steam generator. Again, cold non-radioactive sodium is pumped into the intermediate heat exchanger, which is inside the reactor. And there again, it picks up the heat and coming back. So the critical component of the reactor is one of these fast breeder reactor system is the steam generator is located outside the reactor, whereas the intermediate heat exchanger, which transfers the radioactive sodium to the non-radioactive sodium, that heat exchanger is located inside the reactor. You said IHS is inside the reactor, and the non-radioactive sodium is going inside, coming outside. We have the secondary pump here, which is not shown. The primary pump is inside the reactor. I will show you it in a separate slide later. So this steam generator is supplying steam to the HP turbine, intermediate turbine, and the LP turbine, three-stage turbine system. And we have the generator and the other conventional power generation system and step-down transformer, etc., etc. Okay, the generator transformer, I mean. And then the conventional steam water system. We have a reheater to increase the efficiency of the steam water system or the steam system. And there the reheater is used for the steam from the cold steam, or the after the first stage of expansion, that steam is used for reheating the reheating the steam which is coming from the steam generator. So the reheating is also done by tapping steam from the after the first stage of steam water system. And now coming to the reactor core or the reactor vessel and the reactor core inside, we have main components: centrifugal sodium pump, control plug, and the shutdown mechanism. We have two shutdown mechanisms, CSRDM and DSRDM, and then the universal fuel handling machine for universal transfer of the fuel subassemblies inside the reactor. And then for taking out the fuel subassembly out of the reactor, we have IFTM, universal fuel transfer machine. I will show you another figure in the subsequent slide. And the IHS, or the intermediate heat exchanger, is located here. And there the the radioactive sodium will be passed into the window. This is the inlet window, and it is coming out after transferring the heat. And the radioactive sodium, as I told you in the previous slide, will transfer the heat to the non-radioactive sodium in the tube side of the heat exchanger, and that will be coming out here, and that will be going to the steam generator, where the sodium heated steam generator will produce superheated steam at high temperature of the order of 510 degrees centigrade, and that steam will be used for running the turbine and producing the electricity. So now coming to some of the critical components of fast breeder reactors, see the shutdown mechanism of PFBR. See, the to ensure reliability, we have two shutdown systems, CSRDM and DSRDM. Anyone will be able to completely shut down the reactor. CSRDM, we have 9 numbers, and DSRDM, we have 3 numbers. DSRDM is exclusively for shutdown of the reactor, and CSRDM can be used for shutdown as well as control of the power. So the CSRDM and DSRDM are the most critical components of a reactor with respect to safety. We have to control the reactor, and we have to shut down the reactor, and two independent drive fast acting. It has to act, and that 400 milliseconds is the time duration permitted. So such as a mechanism have been designed, developed, manufactured by Indian manufacturers, and their performance have been tested at the sodium in the sodium facilities in Engineering Hall 3 and qualified. I will give some highlights of the testing which we have carried out. So I told you that there are 9 CSRDMs and diverse safety road dye mechanism, DSRDM, 3 numbers. This is the photograph of CSRDM and the upper part and lower part, and DSRDM upper part and lower part. DSRDM 3 numbers and CSRDM 9 numbers. So these critical components, the development was a challenging task, and ensure the dropping time, it should act within 400 milliseconds. So that was a very challenging task, and very detailed design analysis has been carried out. Initially, the components of these shutdown mechanisms like electromagnet, the dashboard, its seals, and the sodium vapor, seals for minimizing the sodium vapor deposit, etc., has been developed. Component level development has been carried out, and the second stage, the prototypes of the mechanisms were manufactured, tested by simulating the actual reactor operating condition. That is 550 degrees centigrade sodium atmosphere. Sodium is at 550 degrees centigrade. All parameters, all reactor condition other than nuclear radiation is simulated in experimental sodium test facilities, and these mechanisms were tested and qualified for 14 years of reactor operation. In fact, testing is continuing, and we will be qualifying it for the entire reactor period of life. And the most important point here is not only the normal operating condition, the accidental condition or the severe reactor condition. There can be misalignment in the subassembly. There can be movement of control rods or safety rods in the reactor. All abnormal conditions of the reactor were also simulated in the experimental facilities, and the mechanism's performance have been tested, qualified, and delivered to PFBR. One of the challenging tasks which IGCAR was completed in the year 2015 or so. Right. Not only the prototype mechanism, all the actually for 9 mechanism, we have, including spare, we have manufactured 12 CSRDM and 3 extra and 1 extra DSRDM. All the mechanisms were tested, not in sodium, in air, and torque measurement, straightness of travel, verification of seal leak tightness, many components are there. All the performance have been tested and satisfied with the performance of all the mechanisms, and they were delivered to reactor in time. And now the shutdown mechanisms are most important. Equally important are the fuel handling machines. See, unlike PHWR, the fast breeder reactors, we have to take a shutdown and then we have to do the fuel handling. Fuel handling means what? The reactor is a vertical vessel, I have already told. The fuel subassemblies are positioned in the reactor core. They are vertically positioned. These fuel subassemblies, we have to take out of the core. And then within the core surrounding region, there are spaces or there are locations. So we have to keep the subassembly after the spent fuel subassembly, we have to keep from the present position to some other position. And similarly, and there we will allow the reactor subassembly to decay the heat. And after keeping the subassembly in the surrounding region of the core for enough period of time, we can take out the reactor subassembly from the reactor core and it can be taken out. Okay. So this transfer arm is used for universal transfer of the fuel, that is within the fuel reactor core for transferring the fuel. We are using the transfer arm. This is the transfer arm machine. And then taking out the fuel assembly out of the reactor, we are using IFTM. So these two major machines, both together, has to be operated for almost 6,000 cycles in the life of the reactor. And every reactor, every fuel handling, 100 subassemblies we have to handle. So around we have to have around 100 subassemblies to be handled. And the cycle of operation will be depending on the, so it will be of the order of 100 or 120 or so. So that fuel assembly handling will be done by the IFTM. So the integrity of the machine, reliability of the machine has to be established, because once this is installed in the reactor, most of the part of the machines we cannot take out. So the transfer arm and IFTM are the fuel handling machines, and that we have tested in sodium and qualified. So this is the transfer arm photograph manufactured by, designed by RDG IG Corp, manufactured by L&T. And to know the complexity of the machine, height is 23.5 meter, weight is 23 tons. And this machine was being tested in IG Corp and qualified and sent to PFBR. The universal transfer machine, IFTM, the major part is this part is inside the reactor vessel. Primary tilting mechanism, where the vertical fuel assembly will be tilted to an angle, and when the angle, it will be going up to the primary ram. So this mechanism, primary ram and primary tilting mechanism, is the most complicated or the most critical component of the fuel handling machine that has been tested by in a test facility in LCTR. In test vessel 2, these mechanisms have been installed and simulated the reactor operating condition as well as the fuel handling condition, and the primary ramp and primary tilting mechanisms were qualified and delivered to Pavini for installation in the reactor. So these are the fuel handling machine and the transfer arm are two important components which I have covered. Another critical component of the fast breeder reactor is the steam generator. We have 8 steam generator in fast breeder reactor, the in PFBR. This steam generator design is entirely different from the FBTR steam generator, because there are certain limitations in the FBTR steam generator design. In situ inspection or the in-service inspection of the steam generator tubes is a safety requirement with respect to from AERB. So the steam generator design we have carried out. There are 8 steam generators. They are vertical steam generator. Around 23 meter is the tube height. Overall height will be some 26 meters or so. They have power of a steam generator is 158 megawatt, and they are basically heat exchangers and 547 tube. Testing a steam generator is practically not possible. So what we have done? We have done, instead of 547 tubes, all other tube size, everything remains same. The number of tubes from 547 we have reduced to 19, 547 to 19. So the power came down from 156 or 155 to around 5.5 megawatt. So they understand the tube size, the tube thickness, the tube length, everything is same. So instead of 547 megawatt, we got a model steam generator of 5.5 megawatt manufactured. That has proven the manufacturing feasibility of steam generator, because all the thing, everything is very similar, only the number of tubes are limited. And the endurance testing of this model steam generator was carried out in steam generator test facility. Heat transfer performance was tested. Our design margin available was around 10%. Not only the normal condition operation, transient studies were also carried out. And the sodium water reaction can take place in a steam generator. The detection systems were tested. Instability in steam generator is a peculiar problem in once-through type of steam generator, which we are used in PFBR. So the instability studies were carried out, and the safe regime of operation was identified. Not only that, the flow-induced vibration measurement of the ST tube has also been carried out. And all the normal operating condition and abnormal operation conditions were simulated in the sodium test facility, and the steam generator performance is found excellent, and that was a it was given a lot of confidence for the designers. And now 8 steam generators were installed in the reactor, and we hope, we are sure, the performance with respect to power and with respect to the stability behavior and all the operating parameters, all the operating performance will be excellent. We are very sure about that. And coming to the decay heat removal, we know the decay heat removal and passive decay heat removal is a safety requirement of all nuclear reactors, and that is the case for PFBR also. For the decay heat needs to be removed to limit the temperature and maintain integrity of components. See, now we have to see all the heat transfer because of station blackout. All the reactor system, power systems, and standby diesel generator, everything goes out. We should have the decay heat removal system, which is completely passive and which can remove the decay heat from the reactor core and limit the temperature within the design limit. That was the requirement. And we have a system called safety grade decay heat removal system. And this safety grade decay heat removal, I am not going into the details of the system. What I want to say is there are 4 safety grade decay heat removal systems in PFBR. Like this, there are 4 systems, and the capacity of the system is 8 megawatt each. And what we did, there was a safety requirement that the passiveness of the decay heat removal system or the effectiveness of the decay heat removal system has to be experimentally demonstrated. We built a sodium system, a model decay heat removal system. We can say a model of the safety grade decay heat removal system of PFBR that was built in hall number 3 FRTG in the LCTR. It was a part of LCTR. Instead of 8 megawatt, it was a 1/22 scale model. 355 kilowatt was the power. Even the 1/22 model, the height was of the order of 46 meters. And in this facility, we have electrical heaters were provided for generating the simulating the decay heat, and sodium to air heat exchanger as in PFBR was provided. We can see the vessel with the electrical heaters which will simulate the decay heat removal, decay heat generated in the reactor core. I am not going into the details of the system, but experimentally we have demonstrated the capability of passive decay heat removal system, and the system which is removed 19% more power than theoretically estimated value. So the effectiveness of the PFBR safety grade decay heat system removal system was experimentally demonstrated. What we do, all the power supply failure will be simulated in the experimental system, and an operator will go and manually open the valve. The flow will automatically set in, and the air flow and the secondary sodium flow and the primary sodium flow, everything will automatically happen, or on its own it will happen, and the heat removal will be taking place, and everything we have, the response time was an important parameter. We found that it will go to the maximum capacity within 8 to 10 minutes. So number of times this exercise was repeated, and the decay heat removal system capability was established. Coming to the material part, we are using 316 LN as the material for the primary system. In secondary system, we are using 9 chromium, 1 moly material because of the sodium water reaction suitability and other things. So these dissimilar metals or materials is also is a challenge. Will lead to corrosion of the structural material. And our metallurgy group is very strong in IGCAR. Metallurgy group was planned N number of testing program. And the bimetallic loop, which is simulating the reactor conditions of two materials together. And thousands of hours we have tested the material. We simulating the surface area ratio, sodium velocity, sodium purity. All operating parameters are maintained with these two materials in one sodium system. And 50,000 hours we have operated. And the corrosion of the material was found negligible. And that was matching with the predictions of our metallurgists in metallurgy group. In addition to that, the high temperature, you know, the fast breeder reactor will operate at a temperature of 550 degrees centigrade. So the high temperature properties of the material and high temperature properties of the material in sodium environment is very important. So the fatigue properties or the fatigue studies of structural materials, 9 chromium 1 moly as well as 316 LN was carried out in liquid sodium at elevated accelerated conditions of 600 degrees centigrade. And we found that the material property in sodium is much better than air atmosphere, because air atmosphere presence of oxygen will lead to corrosion, whereas in sodium the oxygen level is maintained with a very low level. So the very low level, because of that the corrosion chances are minimized, so the material performance are better. In addition to sodium testing, basically pool hydraulic studies, the flow distribution, flow induced vibration. Such studies normally we carry out in water facility. We have 1-4 scale model SAMRAD, where the all major important geometry of the prototype reactor is simulated. And basically the non-dimensionless numbers are simulated, and the flow induced vibration, flow distribution basically, and flow asymmetry, if any, all those things are monitored in the 1/4 scale model water test facility. The temperature will be of the order of 60 to 70 degrees centigrade. In addition to the major components, many sensors required for fast reactors. Basically, the sodium flow meters, sodium level sensors, and diverse leak detectors of mutual inductance type leak detectors, eddy current type flow meters, crosswire type leak detectors, and sodium ionization detector, which will be able to detect even nanograms of sodium particle in ambience. If a sodium leak is taking place and the sodium is coming, sodium aerosol is coming to the the reactor building or the steam generator building, the sample air we can sample, and if the aerosol particle level is in the range of nanograms, we will be able to tell. Yes, a sodium leak is taking place, and we can take the remedial action or the precautionary action accordingly. And the under sodium ultrasonic scanner, I will explain it in another slide. So these various senses, you see, what I want to say is sodium being a very reactive element, and sodium being a very, sodium system is operating at a temperature, a very high temperature. So this very high temperature and chemically reactive nature of sodium prevents conventional sensors cannot be used in fast breeder reactors. So we have to develop sensors and instruments which is specifically useful for sodium systems. And I can proudly say in IGCAR, all the sensors required for PFBR and future BR reactors were successfully developed, tested, qualified, and this performance was been confirmed and delivered to Bhavini in time. And this is the one case where the a special requirement, the sodium pump, we have the grid plate here, and the sodium, these centrifugal pumps are driving, the driven by induction motors, and these centrifugal pumps will be injecting sodium into the bottom of the grid plate. And here we want to know what is the flow of the pump, or the how much flow is delivered by the pump to the grid plate, or how much is the reactor core flow, for example. So the reactor core flow monitoring we are doing by measuring the pump outlet flow. For that, a flow meter by name eddy current flow meter has been used. And the important thing here is this eddy current flow meter located here, we should need a very complex mechanism. And this is the system for that, which is eddy current flow meter installation setup. So it has to be, we should be able to withdraw the flow meter from the reactor top, a long tube inside that the sensor is located, and two sets of sensors are there, and there are shielding and other things here. Many other components are there. So what I want to say is such a eddy current flow meter has been used, and that has been modified. I mean, eddy current flow meter has been modified suitably, and with additional devices, it has been successfully deployed for measurement of flow in the reactor core. And another sub-assembly flow per se. Previous one was for the entire core flow measurement. In some occasions during fuel handling and after fuel handling, it is necessary to measure the flow in each sub-assemblies, because if there is a blockage, it can lead to a very dangerous situation. So we have devised core flow monitoring mechanism using ECFM and device for fuel sub-assembly measurement, flow measurement, and device for blanket sub-assembly flow measurement. Both are slightly different. These devices were measured, we were developed, tested, and delivered to the reactor. We delivered to Bhavini for the actual use. And then level sensors, again, conventional level sensors will not work. Mutual inductance level sensors were developed. These level sensors were calibrated in sodium, and the performance and accuracy levels were established, and the around 29 level sensors with the temperature compensation was an important parameter, because the level, when the sodium temperature changes, the level should read the same irrespective of the sodium temperature. Some electronic electrical compensation is required. So we have estimated, and with all the fine tuning, the level sensors and electronics were delivered to Bhavini for use in the reactor. And as I told earlier, unlike water, the sodium is an opaque liquid. But we have to view the subassemblies which is inside the reactor pool. I told you 1,110 of opaque sodium in the reactor vessel, and most of the components are inside the reactor vessel with which is opaque. So we cannot see what is inside, but we have to see in some cases how the subassemblies, how the components are behaved during reactor operation, and where severe nuclear radiation and severe fluence is, the reactor core is subjected to severe fluence. And what we do is during fuel handling location, using an under-sodium ultrasonic scanner, by just like human body scanning, this scanner, which is operating in sodium atmosphere, which is operating at a temperature of 200 degrees centigrade, was developed in IGCAR, tested by simulating all the reactor conditions, and then delivered to Bhavini for the reactor use. It is with Bhavini now. And sodium leak detectors, the one thing which can go wrong in a fast breeder reactor is sodium leak. You know, sodium is very good. It's a very good heat transfer medium, very good fast reactor coolant. But if it is leaking outside, it is very dangerous also. So the leak detection, redundant leak detectors are required. And we have developed wire type and then sodium ionization detector, which will detect the sodium particle, presence of sodium particle in air. Mutual inductance type leak detector, which will detect the, which is a standby detector, we can say. The sodium detector, basically wire type, is based on the conductivity principle. Liquid sodium will bid two wires and then give an electrical signal, and that will give an alarm in the control room. And now the question is, if a leak is taking place, how much time it will take to detect? Because entire piping, we cannot provide the leak detectors. We have to provide the leak detectors at the various locations. In a very judicious manner, we will provide leak detectors. But the question safety authorities were asking, in your sodium system, if a leak is taking place, how much time it will take to detect? And we have conducted experiments. Actual leaks were simulated in sodium system, and the detector response time was evaluated. A small leak of 100 gram per hour can be detected within 4 hours. That is very small leak rate. Even at within a very small time, we are able to detect, and that was meeting the international safety requirements and the AERB safety guidelines. So that way, our detectors were qualified and it meets the safety requirement. Another important component in a fast breeder reactor is electromagnetic pumps. See, sodium being a good conductor, without a motor, this pump can be used, and the pumping will be taking place without any rotating parts. Such electromagnetic pumps are developed. Variety of 3 different types of electromagnetic pumps were developed. Flat linear induction pump was an old version which we have used for experimental facilities. The most robust type of electromagnetic pipe, which is the latest in the technology internationally, annular linear type of induction pump. Different types of pumps were required, of different capacity pumps were required. All these pumps were designed in IG Corp, tested, manufactured by Indian industry, tested in our experimental facilities in the actual operating conditions and accidental operating conditions also, qualified and then delivered into a reactor. Of course, there was some difficulty with some of the pumps which we have delivered to Bhavini. And we have done extensive investigation, and we could find out the root cause, and IG Corp could rectify the problems. And now the electromagnetic pumps are performing in an excellent manner in PFBR, I can say. And another important device is the cold drop. Cold drop is the device for purifying sodium. We have developed cold drops which are having very high efficiency. And these cold drops in secondary state, we need to regenerate the cold drop. That means the cold drop which will get filled up with impurities in 5 years of operation. Then we have to take out the impurities, mainly hydrogen. So the regeneration technique or the methodology was established. Experiments were conducted and the regeneration technology was proved. And now the design of the system for PFBR is being carried out. And now coming to the future fast breeder reactors. Our posterior reactor PFBR is not the, it's only the beginning, I can say. We started with FBTR. FBTR was our first reactor, FBTR, which was been made critically in 1985. Till today, it is operating. And the PFBR, 500 megawatt reactor, is the next stage. And after PFBR, almost the same design. After PFBR, commercial FBR, that is CBR 1 and 2 or FBR 1 and 2. The size and everything will be more or less same. But the power, we can take more power. We can tap more power from this the same core, I can say. So the power is increased to 600 megawatt, and that will be our next step. And these reactors, FBTR was a carbide and diethyl oxide, and the PFBR is a plutonium oxide fueled reactor, and the FBR 1 and 2 also will be oxide fueled reactor. But the breeding gain, the multiplication ratio, or the amount of plutonium produced, that should be high, but there is limitation when you go for plutonium oxide fueled reactor. So we have a plan to go for, we have decided to go for metallic fuel, where oxygen atom is not there. Neutron economy will be higher, and the breeding gain or breeding ratio will be higher. The multiplication factor will be higher. The amount of fuel produced in the blanket in a metal fuel reactor will be much, much higher compared to an ocean fuel reactor. So we are going for a metal fuel test reactor, and then later, probably after 10 or 15 years, we are planning to go for a metal fuel reactor of 1,000 megawatt capacity, and then such reactors will be standardized, and that is our ambition, or that is our plan with respect to future reactors. I can say the experimental facilities and the what you call the infrastructure available in IGCAR is able to do the development, testing, everything for this metal fuel reactors also. And I can proudly say the refuel cycle related activities of the metal fuel is already won in IGCAR, and for the last 7-8 years, and many much progress has been done. I don't know the exact status because I was out of picture for the last 5 years. So now I conclude, EBR technology development started in 1965 in BARC, in RED in 1965 by Mr. Paranjpai, Sir Paranjpai, and that led to the successful operation of EBTR. Later, critical components and systems of PFBR were developed and tested and delivered to PFBR. And we have adequate facilities, mainly sodium facilities, water facilities. We have 1 dozen sodium loop with a sodium systems, inventory ranging from 300 kilogram to 100 tons, very huge facilities. And the sodium technology complex is coming out, which is able to handle many, many large components. So very large facilities or adequate facilities are available. And I can proudly say India is one of the country which is having such a good number of facilities with a good flexibility also we have. Successfully designed and developed innovative sensors and devices for EBTR. And not only that, we handle sodium from the very beginning in 1971 always. Sodium temperature is of the order of 550 degrees centigrade. And in all our sodium facilities and all our experimental facilities, the safety record is excellent. So 49 years or 50 years of excellent safety record we have. That gives confidence that we can operate PFBR in a safe manner. What I have presented here, only a small fraction of work done in IGCAR towards PFBR or EBTR. Our vision is to become a global leaders in fast reactor technology. Before thanking the audience, I wanted to thank the association, Retirees Association, especially Mr. M.B. Rajan, Dr. M.B. Rajan, Mr. Govindan Kutty, Mr. Nambudiri, and all my friends, Mohandas, Mr. Vinod, and many other people who are known to me, and many other people I know by the name, very familiar, but anyway, I wanted to thank all the people who are all my colleagues who have worked for this and the association opportunity. With these few words, I conclude. I thank everybody. Thank you.